At the heart of Denmark's capital city, Copenhagen, you'll find probably the most elegant theme park in the world. The Tivoli Gardens first opened to the public in 1843. Nowadays, it's a playground for the modern Danish people. The happiest nation on earth, according to the UN. At the centre of the park is the Hans Christian Andersen ride, named after Denmark's most famous writer. But as you disappear beneath the ground, you find all is not quite as it seems. Brightly painted automata reenact the master storyteller's fairy tales. The Emperor's new clothes. The Snow Queen. The Little Mermaid. The presentation might look cheerful, but in truth, Andersen's fictions are disturbing. Tortured lovers, deranged tyrants, innocents doomed to a premature death. The tales of Hans Christian Andersen aren't just fairy stories for children. They're often extremely dark, and I think they speak volumes about the often uneasy Danish sense of self and sense of national identity. Denmark's story is that of a small kingdom with an ambitious king. Ambitious to possess great art as well as a mighty empire. It's a history of broken dreams, catastrophic adventures, and a precarious survival into modern times. Long after the dreams of empire faded, the art of Denmark would remain powerful and haunting. Like Hans Christian Andersen's most famous creation, Denmark was the duckling that longed to be a swan. Once upon a time, at the turn of the 17th century to be precise, Denmark was ruled by a proud and lusty king. Christian IV was a king on the crest of a wave. His navy ruled the seas. He was the most powerful ruler in all the Nordic lands. Like any great king, he wanted the greatest palace in the world, and he got it. So this is it, the grand courtyard of Frederiksborg Castle, the most spectacular palace ever built in Denmark by the most ambitious Danish king who ever lived. It's tremendously grand, absolutely beautiful. Christian IV was a man with huge appetites. He'd travelled abroad, he'd seen the great architecture, the great sculpture of the Renaissance and the Baroque, and he wanted to create his own version of it here. He had a problem. He rules a nation where 99% of the population are humble farmers. Who is going to build his great castle? The answer is he has to import it all. German goldsmiths, German painters, and a Dutch architect, Hans van Steenwinkel. Mannerist relief work and sculptures, this great red brick, like a private palace in Holland, except on an unimaginably vast scale. Imposing as it is from the outside, Frederiksborg Palace is even more sense-stunning within. A ballroom the size of a football pitch, and miles of corridor connecting glittering state chambers. This is my favourite room in the whole palace. Here we are at home with King Christian IV of Denmark, very much the swan in this graceful, elegant portrait by a Dutchman, Peter Isaacs. Of course he's a Dutchman. There he is with his baton of command, crown and helmet, an allusion to his recent victory over Sweden. Christian IV was known not only for his intellectual prowess, his ambition, but also his vigorous potency. He had two wives during the course of his long reign, and more mistresses than you can shake a stick at. Here is his first wife, painted by a Danish artist, Rennerts. Anna Catherine, Princess of Brandenburg. Poor lady. Seven children in 9 years, followed, predictably, by an early death. She passes, gives way to the love of his life, Kirsten Munk. She's even more prolifically receptive to his affection. She bears him 11 children in 13 years before committing adultery with a German count. That didn't go down well with our man, Christian IV, so he had her banished and carried on with his many mistresses. Christian was a king who believed God was on his side. The palace chapel is like a bejeweled casket. It's one of the most splendid private chapels to survive from all of Baroque Europe. And at the heart of it, made of ebony, silver and gold, pure gold, a great altarpiece. And what a monument it is to Christian's desire to pay homage to his God, perhaps in hope of military victory. At the centre, we've got this tremendously vivid crucifixion. And above, all done in silver, Christ holding the banner of his victory over death. He exits the tomb in a flash of metalwork light. Completely brilliant. And as often with these splendid royal commissions, there were layers built in to the object that only the king and his priest would ever see. And I'm very lucky because the verger has kindly let me open this central compartment, which shows the Last Supper. There's Judas with his twisted, uneasy body clutching his bag of silver. There's Jesus Christ. And in front of him, they seem to be having a rabbit as their Last Supper. Now, you open it like this. I've had my training. And you let it rest on the key. And there at the very centre, we've got the Nativity. It doesn't even end there. Inside here, I think it's where the wafer would have been kept, because on this panel here, etched rather than created in relief, almost like an engraving on silver, we've got an image of Christ being circumcised. Inside here, we've got another little world, this time of wooden inlay. Looks like an Italian cityscape. Isn't that a fantastic thing? Christian IV's altarpiece, secret compartments and all. Christian would turn Copenhagen into a grand city to rival any European capital. And at its heart, he built an astronomical tower to pierce the secrets of the skies. Christian himself would ascend its great spiral ramp on horseback to survey the heavens. This great phallic astronomer's tower protruding up from the centre of Copenhagen is one of the great symbols of Christian IV's reign. To chart the position of the stars was also to be able to navigate the seas. He wanted far more than to be the king of a small principality. He wanted to occupy and to colonize the world. The ambition was immense. But the truth is that it wasn't really to be. How are we to think of him? I think that Hans Christian Andersen is quite a good place to start. Was Christian IV really the swan who came out of the ugly duckling? Or was he perhaps the emperor strutting in his new clothes, but actually naked, vulnerable to the other greater forces of Europe? That turned out to be the case. The great castle, Frederiksborg, was really just a house of cards. This great tower was really just a Tower of Babel. And the story of Denmark would be the story not of a nation that grew and grew and grew, but the story of a dominion that shrank and shrank and shrank. Poor Christian, his dreams would come to nothing. And Denmark, rather like the princess in another fairy story, fell into a deep sleep for more than 150 years. Who would wake her up? Not a prince, certainly not a king, but the child of a humble shoemaker. Born here, in the sleepy streets of Odense, in the middle of Denmark, he, with a little help from his friends, would take the nation on a new adventure.
So, Henrik, where have you brought me?
This is actually the childhood home of Hans Christian Andersen. So this was the space in which he grew up from he was 2 till he was 14 years of age. And over here, we have his father's working table. We have his working tools. He was a cobbler, a very poor cobbler. And his mother was a washing woman.
Are you saying that this, however many square meters it is, was the whole family?
Yes.
Well, there aren't other rooms that are missing.
No.
This is it.
Yeah, they were from the lowest parts of society. But still, they had access to the highest parts of society. Hans Christian Andersen played with the future king as a child because his mother washed clothes for the king.
So it really was a small world, almost fairy tale small.
Yeah, exactly.
Goodness me.
Yeah. He was very lucky in a sense because there was made a school law, and it was just about the time where people start to learn to read and write. When he was born, almost nobody could read and write in Denmark. And also, he knocked on doors of people who were more well-off and had books. So when he went off to Copenhagen, he had already read Schiller, Klopstock, Shakespeare. And he says that he liked Shakespeare the best because it was the bloodiest. And he would reenact the Shakespeare dramas in his little puppet theatre.
How fantastic. So he really was, so to speak, a self-made duckling.
Yeah.
I mean, if anyone made him into a swan, it was he himself.
Yeah, it was.
There's a strong vein of social satire in Hans Christian Andersen's stories. When the great and the good appear, they're usually rather absurd. Think of the emperor with his new clothes, or the princess who's so hypersensitive she can feel a pea through 20 mattresses. I think Andersen always remained the cobbler's son, a man with a sharp eye for social inequality. He knew that there were two Denmarks, one for the rich and one for the poor.
But behind his tales, you can sense the outlines of a new Denmark taking shape. A place where the humble son of a cobbler might feel just as worthy as any king. It's no coincidence that Andersen's heroes rise from humble origins. Most famously, the swan chick reared in the wrong nest. But Andersen can't be reduced to black and white. He was a melancholic bachelor, as well as a successful writer. And it was as an artist, a maker of visual images, that he most fully revealed himself, anxieties and all.
You must be Pia.
Yeah.
Andersen's art remains very little known, kept under lock and key in his hometown, under the watchful eye of conservator Pia Hansen.
So this is the conservation studio?
Yes. And, yeah.
And this is the... You've got it all ready for
me.
So these are very, very rare, precious objects. They are paper cuts made by Hans Christian Andersen himself, often for the entertainment of the children of the people with whom he spent much of his itinerant life staying. And here we have, may I pick it up?
Yes.
The golden swan. Isn't that beautiful? The great image of Danish hope. I always think this is what Denmark wants to become. Itself.
Yeah.
Denmark thinks it's the ugly duckling and it wants to become the swan. Isn't that lovely? And how wonderful to have preserved it. I feel like a child in a sweet shop. Isn't that wonderful? I love the colours that they've been placed on. So that's a windmill, a sort of animated human windmill with a dangling dancer, some children at the bottom with umbrellas.
I think I read somewhere that the word for mill or grinder is the same in Danish as it is the word for an artist.
Yes, Marla. That's exactly.
So, and the windmill, I noticed, has got the windmill's got fountain pens for arms. So maybe this windmill is Hans Christian Andersen's portrait of himself grinding away, turning out his stories. How many of them are there altogether? 50, 60, 70?
More.
Not so many.
More?
Yes.
Wow.
But these are the greatest hits.
Some of them.
Oh, no, what's this? Isn't a paper cut. This is a block.
No, this is
a,
yes.
So
it's
he's
an indrawing.
So he's created the image and then he's unfolded
yes,
it.
Yes, and then made some lines. Yes.
Wow. Mm. I like to imagine that that's the emperor.
Yes.
This is when he still does have clothes, and he's about to try on the naked suit. I've sometimes wondered if the emperor with his new clothes isn't Hans Christian Andersen's allegory of all these disastrously idealistic or dreamy kings of Denmark who lead them into great battles, which they then promptly lose. You know, all the Danish emperors perhaps have no clothes. Gosh.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, what on earth do you make of this? The three-headed creature. It seems like an image of the divided personality. Mm. Somebody who presents one face to the world, the smiling face, but the other faces look to the side. So what have we here? You've saved the... Oh, you have! You've saved the best for last, or certainly the most sinister for last. Isn't this something? This is the Heart Snatcher. And I think this is an image that really goes to the centre of Hans Christian Andersen as a person, always disappointed in love, always feeling that somehow it's not going to work out for him. And this is his revenge on Cupid, this image, because there is Cupid. He's got somebody's heart in his hand, and he's hanging from a gallows because, as Hans Christian Andersen explains, he is the thief who deserves to be hanged, and on this side is the man who's lost his heart. See the little heart down at the bottom? He's lost his heart, so he's dying for love, and Cupid deserves to die for making him fall so fatally in love. But that really is an image that goes to the heart, forgive the pun, of the work of Hans Christian Andersen. Thank you so much for showing me these. If Hans Christian Andersen was the heart of 19th century Denmark, another man was the mind. He was a humble priest, inspired by the Enlightenment, who preached education for all. He believed that every man and every woman should be given the key to learning and given the chance to rise. He gave his sermons here at Copenhagen University, and his name, Nikolai Grundtvig. He founded the Danish Society, and it met every Tuesday evening in rooms like this one, rented for the occasion. And the great difference between the Danish Society and the university was that the society was open to everyone. They were so popular that the government came to regard them with suspicions. We've got some wonderful descriptions of them, written by government spies. One such spy wrote, "It's extraordinary, all kinds of ordinary people, cobblers, tailors, servants, attend these meetings, and at the end they're so enthused, they break out into song." The subjects ranged widely from early 13th century Danish history to Danish architecture, Danish archaeology, but they were always on Danish themes. In a sense, the subject matter wasn't that important. The idea behind it was what counted. The notion that all Danes, from whatever social class they might come, had education as their birthright. And what this marks also, I think, is a great shift in the general perception of how society works. Society was no longer, so to speak, a clock set by the absolute monarch. It was something much more amorphous and something driven from beneath, driven by ordinary men and women. That was where the future lay.
Ordinary people could become extraordinary. None more so than an 11-year-old boy who went on to become one of Europe's most famous sculptors. So famous, that the Danes would build a great temple to him in the heart of their capital city. He'd made his fame and fortune in Rome, and the people welcomed him back like a Roman emperor returning triumphant.
Talk about a rags-to-riches story. Bertel Thorvaldsen rose from humble origins to become not just the most famous artist of early 19th century Scandinavia, but the most famous artist of 19th century Europe. Rome was the centre of the art world at the time, and at the centre of Rome was Thorvaldsen. He might not be a household name today, but when he was at his peak, anybody who was anyone coming to Rome had to have themselves carved by Thorvaldsen. Here we see Lord Byron as Childe Harold on the point of utterance. Apparently Byron didn't much like Thorvaldsen's sculptures of him. Here's another one. He felt that they were insufficiently melancholy. Thorvaldsen set out to make the art of Greece and Rome his own, to possess its forms, to bring classical sculpture in all its marmoreal perfection into the realm of Scandinavian art. Stendhal, the French writer, criticised Thorvaldsen, said that his figures tended to be a little inert, and I think that image of static beauty was something that Thorvaldsen worked very hard to create. He mastered the classical technique of carving in low relief. He studied Roman sarcophagi. He looked perhaps at the Elgin marbles of the Parthenon frieze. His output was unparalleled. This is his answer to Canova's Three Graces, and in its time it was every bit as celebrated, the image of female beauty. And at the end of this great long enfilade of rooms, we find Thorvaldsen himself, this large, blonde, phlegmatic Scandinavian. He's depicted himself as a kind of cross between Vulcan, but also Thor with his hammer. He's a Norse classical hero. And I wonder if in that hammer, so prominently clutched in his right hand, there isn't also a memory of his very low origins. He was the son of an Icelandic emigre who'd come to Copenhagen to find work as a woodcutter. And it was in helping his father in cutting wood that Thorvaldsen's talent for sculpture was discovered. This museum didn't just mark the rise of a single man. It marked a moment in the nation's history. In 1849, a few months after the Thorvaldsen Museum opened, the people took power from the Danish king. It was a bloodless, almost fairy tale revolution. "Can I go back to bed now?" the king reportedly said to his advisers. At last, Denmark could be ruled by ordinary men and women. Denmark is at the crossroads, and now it's going to stand tall and proud. And this sculpture, it's Thorvaldsen's masterpiece, it's Jason and the Golden Fleece. I think this unlocks the whole museum's meaning. As one of his contemporaries said, when Thorvaldsen's works came back to Copenhagen from Rome, he has brought with him the Golden Fleece of the classical past. But I think it was a classical past that had a huge meaning to Danes in that present moment. They felt that if any one nation really could reincarnate the great values of the classical past of Republican Rome and ancient Greece, it was the Danes. So what began perhaps as a personal statement for Thorvaldsen, this sculpture, became a national statement for Denmark. It's an image of the country itself, with its eye on the future. It's captured that golden treasure, the ideal and the idea of democracy, and it isn't going to let go. Denmark was moving forward. The people's spirit had been expressed in sculpture, but the people themselves would be brought to life by the greatest painter of the time.
Christopher Eckersberg, another poor boy made good. At the start of his career, he still had to pay court to the Danish nobility. Far away on the southern Danish coastline is the Valdemar Castle. Young Eckersberg came here to seek the favour of a wealthy baron, and the castle still contains the work he made. A very unusual conception.
So, how was an artist in early Enlightenment Denmark to scrape a living? Well, among other things, he had to create sidelines, pictures to divert and entertain the Danish nobility, all of which brings me to this rather wonderful object. It's one of the best kept secrets of the Danish art tradition, and it is Count Juul Prokof's saucy cigar box. How did it work? Well, after dinner, the Count would come here to his billiard and smoking room with his male guests, only men were allowed in here, and he would offer them, in turn, a cigar. When everybody had taken their cigar, he would reveal the little trick at the heart of the box. He would lower this panel and reveal an image in the lid. Shock, horror! A couple making love. It's like a Boucher or a Fragonard, a French jeu d'esprit, but in Scandinavia, the genitalia are in full view. The man is proudly erect. It's extremely explicit. Now, you could see this object as simply an early example of the famous Scandinavian openness about sexual matters, the very first Danish porno, but I think there's more to it than that. The artist responsible was familiar with the work of the other famous Hans Christian of Enlightenment Denmark, Hans Christian Ørsted, the great scientist who discovered electromagnetism, and his theories about the attraction between the magnetic poles were applied by the artist to the sexual act. So yes, this is a light-hearted, erotic work of art, but it's very much also an Enlightenment object. Like Thorvaldsen, Eckersberg and other young painters were given grants by the recently founded Danish Royal Academy to travel, not just within Denmark, but into the wider world.
There's a wonderful sense of freshness about Danish painting of the Golden Age, encapsulated by Thomas Lyndby's beautiful panoramic landscape. It's as if gazing across these rolling acres of Danish farmland, bathed by the sunshine, he can see a new utopia. But these artists didn't just travel the Danish landscape, they also travelled further afield. They were the first generation of properly, professionally trained Danish painters. So where did they go? They went to Italy, flirting with the servant girls, finding picturesque figures like this priest reading with the hills of Rome in the background. They travelled, they visited the archaeological sites, they studied picturesque peasants peeling cabbage leaves. And when they came back, they present to their contemporaries, ordinary men and women, images of their own faces. This is the first non-aristocratic, non-royal tradition of portraiture. And I think this, for me, is one of its masterpieces, Eckersberg's portrait of a landowning count and his wife. And there's something almost hyper-real about it. Look how close they seem. It's almost as if they've got their noses pushed up against the glass of the past. They stare at us, or is that through us? And they seem almost unnaturally healthy. They shine like freshly picked apples.
To get to the core of Eckersberg's genius, you have to come to the Danish Royal Academy in Copenhagen. Camilla Cattle, the Academy's historian, is my guide.
And before it was an academy, it was a royal palace.
Exactly.
It's almost part of this transition from a monarchical to a democratic...
Yeah, you could say so, yes.
Eckersberg came here as a young man with nothing but talent. He was formed here. He walked these stairs and corridors.
Hello.
Yes, please.
This building was the centre of Denmark's artistic revolution.
So these are the modern photographic
studios. Yes.
And at its centre, though it takes some time to penetrate the labyrinth, are some of Eckersberg's most daring pictures, given by the artist himself to inspire future generations.
The age of the Enlightenment opens up before us. How fantastic. Eckersberg was one of the first Danish artists to create memorable images of the naked human form. Now, these pictures were never publicly exhibited. Had they been, they might have rather scandalised his contemporaries, who weren't used to seeing nude human beings on the walls of their art galleries. And they're unusual in many ways. Most artists of the time who did depict the nude did so in preparation for grand mythological subjects, paintings of classical heroes engaged in valiant activities. But these pictures don't breathe any of that heroism or valour. They're very quiet, very modest, very unassuming. They're both guards here at the Royal Academy whom Eckersberg paid to pose for him. This model seems simply to be examining a wound in his hand, whereas this blonde model, looking out with an expression in which determination to stand still for the artist is mingled slightly with boredom. He holds a straight piece of wood to enable the artist to create a true line on his canvas. His clothes lie by his side. When I look at these pictures, I almost don't think of them as nudes. They're paintings of human beings who happen not to have their clothes on. And it's even more true of his female nudes. These would have been even more risque had they been publicly exhibited, because it was actually against the law in Copenhagen, as it was in London in the late 18th and early 19th century, for a woman to pose naked before a male artist. In this case, we don't have any idea really who these two ladies are. The indication is from this picture, look at that rather large, slightly red hand, that perhaps they are serving women, certainly working women, who, again, Eckersberg has paid so that they will pose for him. And they're remarkably unprurient, remarkably unerotic, remarkably straightforward. Think of the great nudes of the European tradition of painting, Titian's Venus of Urbino displaying herself erotically before the gaze of the implicitly male viewer. There's none of that sense in these pictures. I think what Eckersberg is trying to do is almost penetrate to the core of what a Danish person is, as if Eckersberg is saying, well, we Danes here in our age of enlightenment, we don't need powdered wigs, we don't need fancy clothes, we don't need allegorical grandiosity to make us better. We are who we are, and we're quite content with that. So here she is, the daughter of the gatekeeper. Now, this picture always used to be hung in the director's office here at the Royal Academy, but she's been fairly recently consigned to the basement, partly perhaps because we've got this terrible modern fear of looking at images of naked children. The shadow of paedophilia hangs over us. It's made an image like this taboo. Whereas for Eckersberg himself, I think this was perhaps his ultimate expression of what the nude might mean for modern Denmark. It's a young girl, naked. The girl at this point, the child, think of the Enlightenment philosophy of Rousseau, represents innocence, purity. I think that for Eckersberg, this child represents Danish society in the Golden Age, in the first flush of innocence and youth. It's a beautiful image, the encapsulation of an ideal.
But Denmark's dreamers and idealists had their enemies. Those who hated the idea of their country as a naked, defenseless little girl. They wanted to clothe her in national costume, put a flag in her hand, arm her with a sword, and send her off to war.
By the middle of the 19th century, Denmark might have freed itself from the shackles of an absolutist past, but it hadn't altogether renounced all ambitions to become a major European power. And the most nakedly jingoistic painting of the period is this one, Mother Denmark, painted in 1851 by a female artist, Elizabeth Jericho Bauman. Here she created the single most famous nationalistic Danish image of the entire 19th century. There she stands, not a classical goddess, more of a Nordic heroine with her Viking jewellery and her ancient sword. Danish flag on her shoulder, ready to march off into a future which the painting seems to predict will be full of military victories, new territories won. There are grey clouds on the horizon, which I think the painter means us to believe are in Denmark's past. But in truth, they lay in the future. This dream of a newly invigorated, powerful military Denmark would prove yet another Danish illusion.
It would be Mother Denmark's sons who paid the price. 1864 was the year of catastrophe. Denmark went to war with mighty Prussia. The Danish army was outnumbered, its weapons inferior, but that didn't stop their nationalist politicians with their dreams of empire. Emperors with no clothes, indeed. Inevitably, the Danes met with defeat. A defeat so crushing, so bloody, that it's become a scar on the national memory. One of the stars of the recent Danish television drama 1864 is actor Søren Malling, globally famous as detective in another Danish serial, The Killing.
So, Søren, it's a very uneasy feeling that I have sitting with you, because I know I'm supposed to interview you, but I expect you to interview me, and because I can't see you except as the policeman in The Killing. I feel like I must be the guilty one.
Time is like 2:30, you are the rest.
So, Søren, 1864 doesn't mean a great deal to many people outside Denmark, but in Denmark it's a date of great significance. Can you explain that?
Before 1864, we felt like we were big, war heroes. We were a huge country. We could do nearly everything. But especially 1864, we lost big time. I mean, for the first time in 100 years, or maybe 200 or 300 years, we lost. I mean, not just lost, we really lost big time.
Was this a bloody war? Did a lot of Danish people lose their lives?
A lot. By that time, I do believe that 8,000 very young boys between 15 and 20 in 2 hours were killed. I mean, the big, big battle who ended the war took only 2 hours. The German came, there were many more, thousands and thousands, and they had better weapons. That was also part of the big mistake from the Danish generals and politicians. If you talk about foreign policy, we became a non-aggressive country. And I do believe it has a big influence on who we are today. Going from a huge country, if you consider all the square meters we had at that time, to a very small country with only 5 million people. It was a kind of mark, and from that mark we started considering more about how to develop a small country. So we actually spent many, many years, trying to figure out who are we as a nation.
The story of Denmark is a mix of light and dark. Bright ideals, harsh disappointments. Danes today still hark back to the time of Hans Christian Andersen, Thorvaldsen, Eckersberg. They call it their golden age. Cut short by the shock of 1864, it was followed by a time of anxious reflection. A silver age, you might say. And its uneasy spirit was captured in the last years of the 19th century, in the quicksilver paintings of Wilhelm Hammershaw.
I think of Hammershaw as one of the first artists to create visual equivalents to what Sigmund Freud described as the sense of the uncanny, that sense that you get when the ordinary world suddenly seems charged with a sense of mystery, perhaps even a sense of terror. This picture, Hammershaw's wife and his mother, a genre painting, a painting of a snapshot of ordinary life, but one from which the meaning has somehow become drained. There are old masterly elements in Hammershaw's work. He was besotted by the art of Vermeer, and you can see that in some of these tender, delicately worked interiors. But there's always this sense of mystery, of strangeness. I mean, this is what the world looks like once it's been drained of grand ideas, great schemes. Look at that figure gazing out of an otherwise empty interior. Even more beguiling is this work of art. It's simply called Dust Motes, and what does it show us? Some light coming through a window. Hammershaw was a contemporary of Ibsen and Munch in Norway. Ibsen, the great playwright of silence, of awkwardness, of anxiety. Munch, the great painter of the scream. And in a sense, I think Hammershaw is responding to the same world that they were responding to, a world of urban alienation. Friedrich Nietzsche's declaration that God is dead, but tellingly, Hammershaw the Dane, he doesn't scream, he whispers. Hammershaw shrinks the world to the space of a room where you could hear a pin drop. But these aren't just paintings of interiors. I think they're paintings of a state of mind, the Danish mentality. Fearful, perhaps. Introverted, certainly. Focused only on what's close at hand. Hearth and home. So what happened next? Well, that's another fairy story. But this time, there'd be no more kings or emperors. No tin soldiers. Denmark entered the 20th century determined to stay out of trouble and put its own little house in order. It's as if the whole nation turned away from the outside world. This is the Funen village, just outside Hans Christian Andersen's hometown of Odense. It quirkily encapsulates a very Danish form of nostalgia. The houses here were all built long ago, and it was only in the 20th century that they were brought together into this heritage museum with quacking ducks and people in historic fancy dress.
Morning, morning.
I think the village is what many Danes would like Denmark itself to be. A self-sufficient fairy tale world, safe from whatever fires might burn elsewhere. It was made by a people who still remembered 1864 and all that.
What is this museum? A beautifully maintained memorial to the lives of the common man and woman. The whole place is like a living film set. Well, it is a film set of the past. The Danish historical drama, 1864, was largely shot in these rooms. But I also think the whole museum is a very potent symbol of the modern Danish national psyche. Much of it was created in the 1940s, at the height of World War II. Denmark was neutral, invaded, occupied. It had its resistance. dark times, but they still found time to create this, a celebration of ordinary, peaceful, domestic life. A celebration of the beauty of small. In the dominion that shrank and shrank and shrank, welcome to the littlest Denmark of all. Lego Denmark. The safest country in the world. Where anyone can build whatever house they want. There's heavy industry, but no pollution. There's a royal palace, but it's only waist high. And I wonder if this isn't more than just child's play. I wonder if Lego doesn't actually make rather a big statement about the way the Danish imagination works. There's something rather quaint about Lego. It represents the very opposite of modern computer play. Single alienated children glued to their screens, killing imaginary foes. Lego brings mother and daughter, father and son together to create something good, something beautiful. You might even say it turns the modern playroom into a mini version of Danish democratic society. Lego is Scandinavia's most famous global export, and you could say it represents 20th century Denmark's one attempt at imperialism. But what a benevolent form of imperialism. Play well, play together. This spirit of togetherness, this love of the small and the safe, is reflected everywhere in modern Denmark, including the language. There's a key word in Danish, hygge, meaning intimate, cozy, comfortable. I think it helps to explain why, here in Denmark during the modern period, they never set out to shock or disgust anyone. To turn taste on its head. Instead, they redesigned objects for the ordinary home, elevating them to the status of works of art. Are you sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin. Danish modern furniture was designed to be comfortable, affordable. This was furniture for all. Practical, useful, but also beautiful. And on a day like this, when the Scandinavian sun is low in the sky, you've got this wonderful transverse lighting, you can really appreciate how these chairs and tables were also conceived by their makers as sculptural objects. And yet, they're for the home. The elegance of Paul Kjærholm's stone table, a simple disc cut from the finest material, just placed there for our contemplation. Wegener's beautiful day bed with its shark's teeth angling mechanism for the headrest. These beautiful struts of wood, which are part practical but part sculptural, very much so. Arne Jacobsen's famous egg chair. I feel as if I'm sitting in an egg. It's absolutely beautiful, but I think it's also very distinctively Danish. How does the modern spirit express itself in different nations, and what does that tell us about them? Think of American modern art, the grand sublimities of Jackson Pollock or Mark Rothko, or the ironic commentaries of Andy Warhol on consumer capitalist society. Think of German post-war art, full of a sense of disenchantment with all the atrocities of the 20th century. There's none of that here. There's no strong sense of irony or tragedy or mystery or misery. What there is, I think, is a determination to get on with ordinary daily life and to make absolutely the most of it, to find and make beauty in your own corner of the world and in your own home. Danish modernism is hygge modernism. For the Danes, small really is beautiful.
And maybe that's the moral of their fairy tale. Some little chicks aren't cut out to grow into swans. In fact, staying small suits them very well. And the ideal of the small, the homely hygge spirit, which lies at the heart of 20th century Denmark. Well, I think it's wonderful. Certainly worth dwelling on. And there's one building which, in my opinion, expresses that Danish spirit more perfectly than any other. A parish church, named after the great Enlightenment educator Nikolai Grundtvig, in the suburbs of Copenhagen. Is this modern Denmark's most beautiful building? Well, I think so. And it's also a space that enables us to measure the huge distance that separates the old Baroque absolutist Denmark from the Denmark of today. Think back to where I started off, in the chapel of Christian IV in Frederiksberg Castle, a space full of silver and gold and rich ornamentations, but also a space essentially created for the contemplation of one single man. This is a cathedral for everyone, a cathedral for the people. Every inch of it breathes the spirit of inclusiveness. It's made from 6 million bricks, roughly the same number of bricks as there are people in modern Denmark. It represents the modern Danish love of modular construction, given a spiritual impetus. This is, so to speak, holy Lego. Also, the Danish love of modern design, the convenient, homely, modern chair, is wedded to a spirit of high idealism. And it reminds me very much of something that Grundtvig himself once said. He said, "Man is not an ape to ape himself or others. He is a being of incomparable divine beauty, whose task it is through generation after generation to participate in a great divine experiment." And I think that too is what this space expresses. So long as the chairs are all empty, the building is not complete. It demands a congregation. What it says is that the higher good, whether that be our sense of God or our sense of society, requires the participation of all. This world is what we make it, but we all have to make it together. And what could be more Danish than that?
There once was an ugly duckling with feathers all stubby and brown, and the other birds in so many words said, "Get out of town. Get out, get out, get out of town." And he went with a quack and a waddle and a quack in a flurry of eiderdown.